Let's see it.
Alrighty, welcome to the After Hours with TC Restani, the podcast. I am TC Restani, and I'm joined by my esteemed panel of experts tonight. We're going to go around the horn and introduce them. Mr. Vinny Capelli is here.
What's going on, TC?
Nothing much. How are you?
It's been not a bad week. You know, it's been all right. It's pretty good. Going to enjoy myself now here at the with the new mood lighting here at the penthouse. I'm liking this. This is nice.
The new mood lighting here at the podcast penthouse. It's very dim and whatnot. It's very cozy and warm, you would say.
Oh, I wouldn't say cozy and warm. It's just very smooth and groovy, man.
Oh,
you know, groovy,
smooth
man.
And groovy
you
is like the podcast penthouse.
I'm going to bring a couple of Vinnie dolls over. You mind later?
Well, you need to bring them over there. I saw you with, though, they needed to be in dim lighting. All right. Speaking of dim lighting, Colonel Bull Montana at the end of the table. How's it going, my friend?
Hey, TC, what's happening, buddy?
That's okay. You don't have to yell into the microphone either. You know that, right?
Yeah.
All right. They can hear you on Pluto.
Okay.
Okay, good for you. South Boston Jeff is in the house.
Hey, what's going on? It is a rather mellow mood and everything. Really high. Well, no, we're really high up on the penthouse thing, but, well, you know I'm always high.
You're always high. Cool. Unbelievable.
Doing good here, yeah.
It's been an interesting week. We lost two icons of icons this week, and I want to reflect on their career and their life and their meaning to the people around the panel. I'm referring to none other than wrestling's most devious manager ever, Mr. Fuji, passed away this past week, along with Willy Wonka himself, Mr. Gene Wilder. We're going to start off with Mr. Fuji, the devious one. Now, everybody at this table grew up as a huge wrestling fan of the 1980s, and Mr. Fuji was at the forefront, one of the stable worth of managers in the World Wrestling Federation. Not the garbage they produce today, the World Wrestling Federation. Now, Vinnie Capelli, your fond memories of Mr. Fuji.
Oh, wow. Well, going back, I mean, you know, growing up as a kid, I always liked the heels. That's for the people that don't know. Those are the bad guys. I always liked the heel character. You got to think about it, though. Fuji stood out in an era where you had Bobby the Brain Heenan.
The greatest manager of all time.
Classy Freddie Blassie. The Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. You had Slick, you know.
The Doctor of Styles.
Doctor of Styles. You know, Captain Lou Albano. So this was an era of wrestling that actually had what used to be managers. You don't see managers no more. Paul Heyman's the closest thing you see to a manager nowadays.
Right.
I would have to say my fondest memory of Fuji was the night he debuted Demolition. Being a Road Warriors fan and not getting to see them for a long time because they were NWA, you know, WWF, or World Wrestling Federation at the time, they really had to combat with something because they didn't have the tag teams. I remember the Orient Express. You know, you had,
Foundation.
The Hart Foundation, which were great. The British Bulldogs.
The Killer Bees.
You had Haku and
Tama the
Islanders. But they just didn't have that, quote-unquote, it factor they talk about. And then all of a sudden, they repackage Barry Dasso, who used to be Crusher Krusev, and they make him into Demolition Smash. They take Axe, and they put these two guys together.
Who was the mass superstar.
And they were phenomenal because when they came out, you saw them in all black with the spikes.
They looked like something out of, quote-unquote, The Road Warrior,
the movie.
Right.
Yes.
But let me give you a little history lesson here. Mr. Fuji did not debut Demolition. You know who their first manager was?
Jimmy Valiant, right?
Close. Luscious Johnny V.
Luscious Johnny V, that's right.
And the original Smash was
Moondog.
Yeah, it was one of the Moondogs.
It was, yes. Was it Moondog Rex?
Spot Rex,
one of them.
And he just didn't pan. Randy Cully is his real name.
Yes.
And it didn't pan out, and they brought in Barry Darso, which was a huge improvement. And the combination of Demolition with Johnny V just didn't mix.
Yeah, it didn't mix at all.
They needed the devious one.
Yes.
And then, I mean, I think it was overnight they just switched managers because they really didn't do a whole big shebang about it. All of a sudden, boom, they went Mr. Fuji, and it was a perfect fit.
The other thing I have to bring up is just the vignettes he used to do with Don the Rock Morocco.
Fuji
those
Vice.
Were the best.
Fuji Bandito,
he
Fuji
was
General.
Hilarious.
For those of you who don't know what we're talking about, back in the 1980s, when professional wrestling went from the smoke-filled arenas to your living room, Vince McMahon, the P.T. Barnum of the wrestling world, made his wrestling organization kid-friendly, and he basically created the term sports entertainment. It was no longer professional wrestling. There was still wrestling involved, but it was more transforming into what you see today. But back then, it was a lot better.
Right.
And they used to do spoofs. The Magnificent Morocco and Mr. Fuji used to spoof TV shows. So obviously, Miami Vice, they spoofed because it was huge at the time.
Mass General Hospital.
It became Fuji General and Fuji Bandito. I think it was spoofing Bonanza or some Western. But those were fantastic. And Mr. Fuji was the king of the ribbers. So for those of you who don't know what a rib out there, it was a practical joke. And Mr. Fuji was the king of the practical jokes. And I remember listening to numerous interviews by wrestlers back then. Mr. Fuji would go to the extent of really taking it personal. I don't know which wrestler he did this to, but he paid a mechanic to remove the engine from this guy's car. So when the guy got up in the morning to turn the ignition on, nothing happened. He lifted up the hood, and the engine was gone. That was Mr. Fuji.
Yeah, that's what I heard between him and Andre the Giant. It was pretty bad back in the day for ribs.
Unbelievable. Now, Colonel Bone Montana, you actually were involved in the world of professional wrestling. I used to see you at the old Boston Garden bringing in all the wrestlers' luggage and whatnot, and you were part of the infamous bull gang that put down the parquet floor at the Garden. So you must have some Mr. Fuji stories of him backstage at the old Boston Garden.
That's right, TC. I can remember the first night that they came in and God rest his soul, brother. I miss you right now. He goes to me, he goes, Bo, here's some money. You got to go to Chinatown to get him some tea.
The herbal teas that they sell in Chinatown.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mr. Fuji was he was a shoot. He was devious in real life with his practical jokes and whatnot. And I remember seeing him one time outside of the Garden before an afternoon show. And he got out of the car with Demolition, and he wasn't dressed in his tuxedo looking like Odd Job from the James Bond movie. He was sitting there with his big gut hanging out with a Hawaiian shirt, sucking down Burger King. So, and kids were all, you know, throwing stuff at him, and he was just, you know, he played his part to the hilt where people hated him 24 hours a day. And I got a big kick out of them saying, oh, there's Mr. Fuji. He's not wearing his tuxedo. He's standing there. He looked more like a Japanese version of Captain Lou Albano.
Well, remember back in the day, there was such a thing called kayfabe.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, that's a dead issue now, but.
Well, it's gone.
Back then, if you saw Fuji, you American man. You know, behind closed doors when no one was seeing it, he'd be like, hey, kid, how you doing?
That's what made wrestling back then more entertaining, because the performers were on 24 hours a day. They could not break character. Nowadays, you know, they're all on talk shows giving out their real names and saying, you know, this is what I did before I was in wrestling. I sell real estate and all that other junk. Mr. Fuji was Mr. Fuji 24 hours a day. Bobby Heenan was Bobby the Brain Heenan 24 hours a day. Randy Savage was, well, he was a shoot. That guy was really like that 24 hours a day. I remember seeing him talking to himself at the end of a hallway one time.
What was he talking to?
Himself.
Was he eating cereal at the same time, too?
No? He was not eating cereal. He was just standing there. And I'm like, looking at him, like, there's no one around. Randy Savage is talking to himself as the Macho Man. I don't know if he was getting into character or whatnot, or he was just completely out of his mind.
You know, Ric Flair said it best, too, not to get off Fuji, but he always said that when the Horsemen, and he's shooting when he said it, when they were the Four Horsemen, they lived like the Four Horsemen.
Right,
they traveled, they dressed, they did everything together. They were a quote-unquote clique. They were the Horsemen. But they didn't walk around in fake $10,000 suits. They bought real $10,000 suits. They drove around in real limos, took real private jets. They were the Horsemen.
Right.
I mean, and like Flair said, so Fuji was one of those guys, again, from that era, that he lived it, he breathed it. It was only behind secluded closed doors that he was able to break what they called kayfabe.
Jeff, your favorite memories of Mr. Fuji, if you have any.
Well, I just enjoyed seeing them at the Boston Garden and everything. Like when I was about in my teens and everything, I'd go down to the Garden and I'd say, you know, I'd meet my share of celebrities and everything. I never got the chance to meet Mr. Fuji himself and everything, but you know, I got to see a few of the choice, a few real good Yokozuna matches and everything. And Mr. Fuji, I got to slap him on the shoulder as he entered the ring, and that's pretty much it. But I just want to elaborate on what you said about wrestlers being in character all the time, especially the bad guys, because when I was about kid about 9 or 10 and everything, I remember I met Jesse the Body Ventura. It was like a dream come true. I was in that back room where they came in. My brother Eddie, who pretty big guy, who used to work at the Garden, got me back there. And Jesse the Body walked out after the night of wrestling, walked out at the announcing, and I asked him for an autograph, and he's like, "No, get away from me, you little jerk." And I was like, oh. And then my brother Eddie was like, "Why don't you give him the autograph, you effing jerk?" And then, like, he just stopped and everything, and gave him that hand, like, "Don't have time," and then walked away. And I was crushed and everything. But yeah, I found out as an adult and everything, and met him again, and he was like, "Hey, I was just playing bad guy wrestler and everything. I hope you didn't take it too personal, kid." That was a few years ago, but yeah.
Well, that's what you wanted when you met your heroes as a kid, if they were involved in professional wrestling. You wanted to meet who was on television, and you did.
Yep, no. I met that jerk. Yeah, I met the jerk. He was always a jerk in the movies, in Predator. What was he? He was in Predator.
He ain't got time to bleed.
And then he was in The Running Man. But he was quite a jerk and everything. And I did take it a little personal. But now I look back on it, it gave me a good memory.
Do you know what he became after he left the world of professional wrestling?
A governor.
No, that's Jesse. I'm talking about Mr. Fuji.
Oh, what did he do?
He actually took tickets at a movie theater in Memphis, Tennessee.
Really?
And they actually posted a picture of him. Channel 5, the local ABC affiliate, they did a whole story about Mr. Fuji, and they had a picture of him working at the movie theater. And what I thought was really funny, his name tag said Mr. Fuji on it. Even though his name was Harry Fujiwara, it said Mr. Fuji.
You know, it's, before we get off the subject, you know, it's something to talk about real quick, because you, myself, Jeff, Bull, we all grew up. Bull older than us, but we all grew
a lot older than us,
but we all grew up, you know, predominantly watching wrestling starting in the 80s.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And let's face it, a lot of these guys are what put wrestling on the map today. Wrestling was never really big. I mean, it was, professional wrestling was there in the 70s, but when it hit the 80s is when it really kind of exploded, you know, and it was the faces like the Hulk Hogan's, Jimmy Superfly Snuka's, Roddy Piper's. But there were a lot of people, what you would call the supporting cast,
sure,
that were the ones that made it, that you either don't hear about them anymore, or that's exactly what happens to them. You know, to me, a guy like Mr. Fuji, Bobby the Brain Heaton, if Classy Freddy Blassie was alive, these are guys that should be like put on like pedestals.
Like a Mount Rushmore of
managers.
Kind
of like a Mount Rushmore of managers, but even still, like, let's face it, you know, they're the ones who helped put wrestling on the map. I fell in love with these guys. And when I was involved in wrestling, I kind of molded myself,
sure,
as a manager around these guys. That's how you learn. So you take a little bit from each one and how they are. I mean, I played the heel character,
sure,
when I was in wrestling. You know that.
Right.
Bull knows that. And
it wasn't really acting, though.
No, it really wasn't acting. But still, it helps to when you pull... You know, you take some of what Bobby the Brain Heenan did. You took what Classy Frank Blatch does.
Basically, what I did when I became a talk show host, I based my original TV talk show show on Bobby Heenan's, the Bobby Heenan show that was on for 4 episodes,
yes,
in 1989. My red sequin jacket is the exact jacket that Bobby Heenan wore as a manager.
And how many heels used the salt in the eyes?
Sure.
I mean, come on. That's a Mr. Fuji trick. Ha, ha, ha. You got salt on your eyes.
And like I just said, Channel 5 made reference to Mr. Fuji passing away. Yeah. That was the impact that those guys had 30 years ago, that 30 years later, they're still remembered. This generation of wrestlers, when they could all die tomorrow in a plane crash, and they may get a little tagline, WWF wrestlers died. They don't have the impact, that the longevity or the or the creativity that these guys did 30 years ago, because they were basically playing themselves with the volume turned up. They didn't have people writing their lines for them or any of that other nonsense. But Banzai, rest in peace, Mr. Fuji. The other guy who passed away this week wasn't a shock. The man was 83 years old, and he had, Alzheimer's or something?
Alzheimer's, I believe.
We could be talking about none other than the wonderful Gene Wilder. I mean, who will forever be known as Willy Wonka from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. I never got the opportunity to meet Gene Wilder. I know people that have, and they said he was an awesome individual, was very fan-friendly, and was just amazing. When I think of Gene Wilder, I think of him as a comedic genius, in his comedies. Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory really wasn't a comedy. That was really dark.
The actual book version isn't even darker. If you actually, the book, but yeah, no, if you look, watch back, I mean, it is pretty dark, and it's riddled with sexual innuendos and drug innuendos.
And Willy Wonka himself was a smartass.
And borderline pedophile. I mean, I'm just saying, by today's definition,
right.
That would be, people would call him a pedophile.
Right, and he hung around with little orange men.
Yes.
So, I'm going to go around the horn and see which is everybody's favorite Gene Wilder movie. I mean, he was in a bunch of them. So I'm going to start with you, Jeff.
Okay, well, I'd like to first add off that, yes, I have met Gene Wilder in my day. I got him at a book signing and everything.
Of course you are. You're the greatest celebrity star of all time.
And, I didn't get to, you know how book signings are. They just try to rush the line along and everything. But he gave me a smile and a nod, and I actually gave him a Wonka bar to sign. I had to pull it out of my pocket and slip it to him, and he signed it and everything. And
that's worth money, though.
Well, yeah, it is. The chocolate's not in it. I took it out and refolded up a piece of cardboard. But hey, it's the real deal. I mean, I'm not gonna bite into a Wonka bar 100 years from now, you know. So
what all the preservatives in it is, I'm sure it would still be fresh.
Can I ask a question, Jeff? Yes. TC, who actually? Because I've seen Wonka candy, but who is the actual owner of Wonka candy?
I have no idea.
Any ideas? I'm just curious. I have to look it up.
I have no idea. So, your favorite Willy Wonka? Your favorite Gene Wilder movie?
Okay, my favorite has to be Young Frankenstein, without a doubt.
Mel Brooks.
Yes, Mel Brooks, Young Frankenstein, because he was absolutely insane in that, a lot of insane rants and everything. And Peter Boyle was excellent.
The late great Peter Boyle.
Oh yeah, the late great Peter Boyle. Wish I had an opportunity to meet him. And just everybody was great in it. Madeline Kahn, the late Marty Feldman, and
well, Madeline Kahn's dead too.
Yeah, they're all.
Only ones left is Mel. Mel's the only one left.
He's the oldest one too, I think.
Well, Terry Gaz still flopping around.
Oh,
we ran into her.
Right.
I'm sorry, that was kind of mean. But if you've seen her, you would agree with me. She kind of looked like droopy, you know, the dog. Hello, folks. But
so Young Frankenstein.
Yeah, Young Frankenstein is my favorite Gene Wilder, and might I add, rest in peace. I was a real fan.
Colonel Montana, your favorite Gene Wilder movie?
Well, I get two favorites of Gene Wilder.
Okay, go ahead.
I believe Gene Wilder played in a baseball movie I can't think of the name, but they were on a bus.
No, you on a bus?
Yeah, they traveled by a bus. And then,
are you sure you're not confusing it with Gene Hackman and Hoosiers?
No.
Are you thinking of the natural?
No. It was before the natural.
Was it a comedy?
Yeah, but
I have no idea what you're talking about.
One of the famous black comedian. He played in on the baseball team.
Maybe during the commercial break we can find out what you're talking about. But you said you had two of them. What's the other one?
The other one would be happy, Willy Wonka with Paris Hilton, with Paris.
Oh, your buddy Paris Thiemann.
Paris Thiemann.
Paris Hilton's not it, but Paris Thiemann is, yeah. He played Mike TV. Yeah.
Why are we talking about him?
Because every time we, all right, for those of you who don't know what we're talking about there, Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, the kid who played Mike TV, Paris Thiemann, for some reason, Bull is close with him. And every time we see him at one of these fan conventions, Bull, I gotta go see my buddy Paris, who, by the way, grew up in Boston. So there is a connection with Colonel Bull Montana and Paris Thiemann. Now, you would have made an awesome Oompa Loompa, Colonel.
He's too tall.
Can you? Well, he could have been the king of the Oompa Loompas. Can you give us a little Oompa?
Oompa, 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 Oompa.
Fantastic out there. Gene, rest in peace on that one over there. All right. We'll look into that. We'll investigate during the commercial break that baseball movie that you think Gene Wilder is. He could have been. I don't know. I don't know his full movie library, but let's go over to Vinny Cabelli, your favorite Gene Wilder movie.
Two, actually.
Oh, okay.
First one is Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Mm-hmm.
One of my all-time favorites. The other one. Hear no evil, see no evil, with Richard Pryor.
Yes.
And you know the thing is, him and Richard Pryor had such chemistry together.
They did three movies together, I believe. And the last one they did, I believe, was See No Evil, Hear No Evil, which came out in 1989. And the plot of that one was Richard Pryor was blind, and Gene Wilder was deaf. And they stumbled across, between the both of them, they heard a murder. And they were being chased down by, that was one of Kevin Spacey's first movies.
Really?
And remember the girl who was in it, Joan Severance?
Yep.
She played Hulk Hogan's girlfriend in No Holds Barred.
No Holds Barred, yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And she did a really nice nude scene in that movie as well. Not in No Holds Barred, but in See No Evil, Hear No Evil.
Another thing, another tidbit about Gene Wilder was he was married to Gilda Radner.
He was.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up because, you know, I am very broken up about his about his death, but I'm kind of liberated in a way because, all right, listen to the way, when they were married and everything, Gilda, you know, she knew that she had cancer, but she kind of thought that she had it beat, so she kept working with Saturday Night Live, and at the end, and she found out at the kind of too late that she got the wrong test results for another cancer patient, and it turned out that she was her cancer was terminal, and she found out she literally had weeks to live, and she died unexpectedly. So the both of them were devastated, but I have great comfort knowing that up in heaven, Gene Wilder and Gilda are back together again.
There you go.
They always said that, I've read, after he passed away, you read up on the people, and they said that after her death, he was never really the same after. He tried to recoup and
he
move on.
He did get remarried.
But they said he never really got over Gilda Radner. The two of them were
Well, it's hard
perfect.
To get over your one true love in life.
Right.
So, all right, my favorite Gene Wilder movie, without question, is Stir Crazy.
Ooh,
great movie.
When they, Stir Crazy was the story, once again, I think it was the second buddy movie with Richard Pryor and Gene Wilder, where they play two New Yorkers who get tired of living in the big city and want to head out west. And on the way, they have these little odd jobs to, make ends meet. So during a lunch break, bank robbers steal the chicken suit, rob the bank, and of course, they get accused of doing it. But the line, the scene that cracks me up, I mean, the whole movie's fantastic, but when the judge sentences them to go to jail for, I don't know how many years, 30, 40, 50 years, or whatever it was, the sounds that Gene Wilder made, whoo, whoo,
yeah.
This, the look on his face was, every time I see that, I piss my pants. That is, without question, that movie, I could watch that 1 million times and never get tired of it. Silver Streak was good too, their first buddy movie, but Stir Crazy, without question, is my favorite Gene Wilder movie. I mean, of course, Willy Wonka, he'll be synonymous with Willy Wonka. It's like Harrison Ford being Indiana Jones or Han Solo. Gene Wilder will, on his gravestone, here lies Willy Wonka.
And there's so many great other ones that we didn't mention, The Woman in Red. And
He had a ton of movies out there, but the ones that stick out are the ones that we mentioned, of course. Now, Colonel, you wanted to say something.
Speaking of, I just found out the gentleman that was Richard Pryor, I believe Mr. Capelli was talking about, was it a robbery scene or something?
Yeah, that was Stir Crazy.
That was Stir Crazy.
No, I mean, not Stir Crazy.
Oh, you're talking about the See No Evil, Hear No Evil.
Yeah.
Right.
There was a train there, and they played a baseball team, I believe.
No, no, you're. I know what you're thinking of. You're thinking of Brewster's Millions. Yes. That's Richard Pryor. Gene Wilder was not in that one.
Right.
Good movie though. You. That was a damn good movie out there.
It was a great movie.
You're thinking of the Richard Pryor 1985 movie Brewster's Millions.
I saw that in the theater.
So did I. But yeah, Gene Wilder. I mean, this has been an awful year for celebrities, especially dying. I mean, you know, I have a list here of, like, there's got to be over 100 names of celebrities that died here. I'm not going to read the entire list, but yeah, you know, some of the big names that have gone this year. Obviously, Gene Wilder, Nancy Reagan, the former first lady. Wow. David Bowie.
Wow. You know,
Prince. I mean, no one saw that one coming. Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
I mean, well, he did have Parkinson's for a long, long period of time.
I was bummed out of Lemmy from Motorhead.
Lemmy from Motorhead. Yeah, yeah, that's music. Yep.
And the one that really affected me the most was Kenny Baker, who played R2-D2 recently down there. You know, but speaking of, and Frank Sinatra Jr., speaking of celebrity deaths, we haven't played this on the radio version yet. We've played it on the television version. It's called the After Hours Death Star Game, where we go around the panel and think of a celebrity we think is going to die before the next episode. So, I mean, there's a long list here. I mean, you can go. There's actually a website called Dead or Alive. That's where I got this list from. You can go on there and just be amazed at how many celebrities have tapped this year. And guess what? The year's not over yet. So, let's see. Go around the horn here. Which celebrity do we think, or do you think, is going to pass away? Now, before we do that, I actually have some fans of ours out there who listen to us out there on our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/afterhours TC, and I tweet out all the shows. And our good friend Maverick, who's our truck driver friend who goes coast to coast and border to border and all points in between, I asked him a little earlier, which celebrity do you think is going to tap before our next episode? And his suggestion was Kanye West.
We could only be so lucky.
Now, I know he's a musician and whatnot.
He's a moron.
And I asked Maverick why him, and he goes, well, his career's dead anyway, so no one's going to care. So that's our good buddy Maverick out there. Keep the pedal to the metal, my friend, and watch the road.
I'll keep my fingers crossed for that one.
Okay. Our good friends, the Geek Force over in England, I asked them today which celebrity they want to see tap before the next episode. And without question, seconds after I asked them this, their response was the Queen of England.
Oh,
Queen, old Lizzie over there. They want Queen Elizabeth to tap before the next episode. That's our good friends over at the Geek Force. Well, Queen Elizabeth did have her daughter-in-law, Princess Diana, killed. No,
what?
No question about that.
What?
You don't? Of course, you don't know that. Remember, 19 years ago.
I remember.
Oh,
I remember.
There was a car accident. I thought. I picture she was going down on that Arabian stallion dude and everything and crashed the car. That's what I always thought.
Well, maybe in one of your sick dreams you thought about that. But Princess Diana actually wrote a letter saying that she believed that her royal family connections would have her killed because she was going against the grain. She divorced Prince Charles, and went with this Arabian stallion, as Jeff just called him. But our friends over in England, the Geek Force, they want the Queen to tap. I mean, she's got to be 250 years old. I think she went to the prom with Yoda.
You realize she can't die because she's cloned like the Emperor.
Oh, no. She's
so when she dies, there's another clone
She's eating the baby parts to keep herself young and fruitful.
That's disgusting.
It is disgusting, but it could be true.
What, the fetal grindings? Like the feet?
I think so, yeah. You know a lot about this stuff, Jeff. Did you have
kind of like a fetal smoothie.
Oh, my God.
Don't give the Colonel any ideas down there. All right. I'm going to say, that's disgusting, a fetal smoothie. Oh, all right. Okay, happy place. All right, let's get that off my head. All right, Vinny Capelli, before you throw up from the fetal smoothie. Now, there's something I didn't think I'd hear today, a fetal smoothie. Who do you think, what celebrity do you think is going to die next?
Before I answer that question, I just want people to understand that I almost want to burst out laughing because when Jeff talked about the Arabian stallion and Princess Diana going down, the motion that happened.
He did the gyrations. I know,
yeah.
He did.
So, yeah. What celebrity do I want to see tap out?
Yeah.
I would love to see one of the Kardashians tap out.
Which one? Or all of
them? All of them would be nice, but
Any one of them.
Really?
One of the Kardashians. See, oh, take the whole family and just blow them
the
all
Kardashians
up.
The Kardashians could be standing right in front of me, and I would have no clue who they are.
If they were standing in front of me, I'd punch them and spit on them.
Well, wouldn't you kill one of them so you could win the contest?
Oh, yeah. I would do
there
that.
There you go. So.
Actually, no. I wouldn't do it. I'd have somebody else do it.
Okay.
You got to be smart about it.
Right. Give him a fetal smoothie.
I'd give him a fetal smoothie.
All right. Colonel Bull Montana, which celebrity do you think is going to tap before the next show?
Marion on Gilligan's Island.
Oh, why
no
would,
way.
No. Don Wells, our good friend Don Wells, who Jeff asked to get high a year ago. You want Marianne, the lovely and talented Marianne, who is a gilf, by the way. She's 80 years old and gyrations galore. She can have some of my coconut cream milk, if you know what I mean. So you think Marianne from Gilligan's Island, you know there are only two of them left. Marianne and Ginger, the only ones left for that 3-hour tour. Now, why would you pick sweet Marianne? What'd she do to you? Are you a Ginger guy?
No, I'm not.
Then why would you pick Marianne?
No, I just want to take a shot on that. You never can tell.
Okay.
I know why.
Why?
Because sweet that he's messing around with again, I bet.
Uh-oh.
Probably doesn't like her.
Really? How is your old flame that's back in your life again? You know, you're kayfabe in that one, huh?
No, it's all done.
Oh, really? A week ago it was back on, and now it's off again, huh?
It's off for good.
Okay.
Are we back with the voodoo queen?
Nope.
All right, well. We'll save that for the Love Connection episode. All right, Jeff, before you give us your answer of the celebrity, why don't you enlighten the fans out there what I just mentioned a few minutes ago, how you actually asked Marianne from Gilligan's Island to get stoned with you.
Oh, I didn't really ask her to get stoned with me. I just pretty much showed her a little something, and I'm like, hey, over the years, you've like turned me on so many times. I just thought I'd like to return the favor. Would you like a little? And she was like, and she saw it, and her eyes opened up, and she was like, oh God, no, I can't be all you know stoned at a family convention. Thanks for the offer, though, sweetie. But yes, it did happen. I did like
ladies and gentlemen, I was there. I witnessed this, and I wish she said yes, because how cool would have that been to go down in the parking garage and get stoned with Marianne from Gilligan's Island?
I think she also would have been nervous. He probably would have masturbated to her, too.
Right there. Knowing him.
Jeff
went?
Knowing him, he probably would have.
Knowing him, you could have gyrated over there thinking he was Princess Di going down on the Arabian Stallion.
I wouldn't be surprised at all. Yeah. Like, at myself, she turns me on that much. Yeah.
All right. Too much information there. All right, Jeff, before these things get completely
Okay, I'm gonna take a safe bet, and I'm going to say Larry Storch from F Troop.
He is about 90 something years old.
90 I've said. They've been wheeling his old bones around forever and everything. It's about time they put that guy in the box and nail it shut. I mean, plenty of good memories of old Larry from F Troop and everything. But,
you mean Aegon?
Yes, you're right. Wow, you do remember that, Aegon. Well, if Quincy didn't kill him, I don't think anything else will, because everybody, if you don't know who our good friend Quincy is, go look it back at our little interview we did with him a couple
That's
weeks ago
true.
Where we was talking about Cheez-Its. Quincy gets really excited around celebrities, and when he saw Larry Storch at one of these fan conventions a couple years ago, Larry was the ripe old age of like 92, and Quincy just made a beeline for him, squeezed his hand, and started screaming the F Troop theme. This guy was shaking like, whoa. So Quincy didn't kill him. I think good old Larry Storch has a few more years left in the tank. All right, my turn. I was going to think of somebody completely different until a couple hours ago when I was reading online that former Baywatch babe, Pamela Anderson, is now speaking out against nudity and X-rated material. She thinks people shouldn't watch it and people shouldn't partake in it. Now, this is coming from someone who made her fortune off of her body. All right, everybody remembers her on Baywatch. I mean, she had on the little skimpy red bathing suit. She did a sex tape with Tommy Lee and sold it and made millions of dollars on it. What this is a big publicity scheme, because no one would want to do her now. Have you seen what she looks like?
Yeah, let's just put it this way. I would rather drink a fetus smoothie than do that.
I mean, I'm not into blondes. I'm not attracted to blondes, but Pamela Anderson was drop-dead gorgeous when Baywatch first started 26 years ago. She's now pushing 50 years old and looks like a wet trash bag. I mean, all those original Baywatch babes are awful to look at.
Except for Carmen Electra.
Okay, no, she's still gorgeous. Yes. I will give you that. But my favorite on the show was Yasmeen Bleeth.
And she's not.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Have you seen what she looks like now?
Terrible.
She looks like she ate Kirstie Alley. It's disgusting what she looks like. So my vote is on Pamela Anderson, just because she's now a hypocrite. I mean, this is a woman who was like Marilyn Monroe. She was nothing but a sex object. That's all she was. She was a horrible actress. She couldn't act her way out of a wet paper bag. Now she's all in an uproar over nudity and all this other crap. What's wrong with these people? I mean, come on. Seriously.
I agree. I think she's a moron. She's a hypocrite. And I still like watching nudity.
Right.
And X-rated material.
Hey, that's what the internet was invented for.
Exactly. I mean, I can give some great sites. I'll do it. If you want to know great sites.
During the commercial break. Right, yeah. Unbelievable. And speaking of commercial breaks, we're going to take our first big-time commercial break. When we come back, we have a celebrity interview that wasn't supposed to air on this episode. Stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Sunny Leone, and you're watching After Hours with T.C. Restani.
Alrighty, welcome back from that big-time commercial break. Now, Colonel Bull Montana, you, over the week, were calling me saying, I'm gonna have a guy come down for an interview. You're going to love it. You promised this all week long that you were going to have a midget ventriloquist in to do an interview. Now, I thought about this. How are we going to know he's not moving his lips when we do radio show, Bull? Did you even think of that when you were trying to book the midget ventriloquist? Are you speechless? Do we need the ventriloquist so you can talk for you?
No.
What do you have to say about the midget ventriloquist who was supposed to be here tonight?
Folks, I'm sorry about that.
Did this person even exist? I mean, where did you find a midget ventriloquist?
I was just taking a walk one day and I met him.
Where, on the beach?
Yeah.
What, did he have a dummy in his hand? And you were like, you'd be good for the radio show. Where? Did he come into the pizza kitchen and get a slice?
Shameless plug.
Okay, there you go. Come on. Inquiring minds want to know. I mean,
I just met him on the beach.
Okay, and you thought, did you not think for a second that, you know, we used to do a TV show, and that would have been a fantastic guest. Are we all in agreement that a midget ventriloquist on the TV version would have been outstanding? We probably would have won an Emmy for it. But we are now doing a podcast, Bull, and a ventriloquist throws his voice to a puppet. How are we going to know he was doing that on the radio?
I don't know.
Okay. All right. Which leads me into our celebrity interview that I needed something to fill the time here because I was waiting for this, you know, ventriloquist midget to show up. But it kind of ties into what we were talking about earlier. Our celebrity interview from the Classic Vault is with my longtime friend, Playboy playmate Jennifer Lavoie. Now, this woman is gorgeous. She bears a striking resemblance to a young Carrie Fisher, and she was the first playmate from New England. And she was on our TV version, and we've converted the file to an audio file so you can hear it on the podcast. This is a last-minute thing, ladies and gentlemen. I had to go to the vault, and I figured, why not have one of the most sexiest women on the planet be part of this episode to cover up Bull's tracks from a midget ventriloquist. So let's set our flux capacitor and our time circuits to go back in time to listen to this classic interview.
Oh, yes.
Hello.
Welcome to the program, Jenny.
Thank you for having me.
Always a pleasure. You know, we've been longtime friends. I'll go back to the mansion out in Los Angeles.
That's right.
Now, for those of you who don't know, I guess Doc Brown's time machine is packed out back because there's no way that you posed in 1993. What were you, 10 years old?
I was 23.
You were 23? No way. Unbelievable. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give it up. So, now, correct me if I'm wrong, you were the first girl from New England that has ever donned the pages of Playboy.
I am the first and still only playmate from New Hampshire.
unbelievable.
55 years.
55 years, and there hasn't been anybody else from New England, huh?
What's wrong with that?
I don't know.
No Maine, no Vermont.
We don't care about Connecticut either. We don't care about Connecticut. So, all right, now how does a small-town New Hampshire girl go from being a small-town New Hampshire girl to the pages of Playboy magazine?
I was actually modeling in New York for an art gallery, and okay. I shot some semi-nudes that were really artsy, and the photographer told me that I should send them into Playboy, and I was thinking, no way, you're crazy. And he ended up sending them in without telling me.
Uh-oh.
So I got a phone call at my mom's one day, and it was Playboy, and I was shocked, but they flew me in for a test shoot, and the rest is history.
And the rest is history. Now, how was that? Now, how was your family all supportive or whatnot?
My family's really supportive. I'm really lucky. I had, like, one person in my family that had a little problem, and, you know, I just set her straight. And
oh, yeah?
But my family's pretty...
A little backhand action, say?
No, it's my grandmother.
Oh, it was your grandmother? Oh, okay. Well, we don't do that.
Yeah. But everybody else was great, so.
Really?
Yeah.
Now how does the process go? You send in the Polaroid pictures and they call you up, and how soon after they called you were you out there doing your thing?
Well, I didn't realize this until 3 or 4 years later, but I guess they get like 350 to 400 applications a day.
A day?
A day. And they just weed it out, but this photographer had actually sent in photos, and they flew me into Chicago for a test shoot. And that test shoot, you basically shoot like a centerfold type shot,
mm-hmm.
and it goes to Hugh Hefner.
Oh yeah,
and
half.
Hugh Hefner is the one.
Friends.
Yeah, half. And half is the one that actually okays if you're going to be a centerfold.
Now, do you have one of those little magnifying glasses I've been seeing? Does he actually like inspect it down to the nooks and crannies?
He gets a pretty big picture, and he gets like an 8x10 size picture. And it was funny because they called me on December 24th and said, you know, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We have a present for you, and you're going to be. And then they called me again. They said, I just wanted to let you know that, Hugh wrote great on your picture. And I was like, big deal. And she's like, no, he doesn't. He never writes anything.
Really?
So I was like, oh, okay.
So you might know, even made the Christmas even more sweeter.
Yeah, it
huh?
was great Christmas.
Now you go out to Chicago. Is that where you did the test shoots out there?
I did.
Right?
I actually shot. There was only, back in the 90s, there was two or three centerfolds a year that would shoot in Chicago, and the rest would shoot out in LA. And I was glad that I shot in Chicago.
Really? You know, I really don't like LA that much out there.
It's a different type of shooting out there.
It's too hot, first and foremost, out there. Now, were you like nervous the first time going out there in front of all the photographers?
I wasn't. I'm comfortable with my body. I mean, I'd have lunch naked. I didn't care. They're like, oh, would you like a
Would you like to go to lunch tomorrow? How about dinner? I think another colonel down there got it.
Yeah.
So now how long does the whole process take? You're out in Los Angeles now. They must take hundreds and hundreds of photos, maybe thousands and thousands of photos.
Well, when I made the centerfold, I flew back to Chicago and I shot my centerfold, the actual centerfold. It took 7 days.
7 days, huh?
And all day, like 16-hour days.
Really?
In one pose. And my pose was so painful.
Now, could you reenact the pose for us?
I probably could.
Now, I know it's not as glamorous to people out there, because I've actually been on these photo shoots, and it's like you have to hold these positions for like 10 hours this way, and like, oh, look this way, don't blink, and all that other stuff.
It's really weird. They're so picky, and they just shoot hundreds and thousands and thousands of pictures.
Now, do you get a say in which picture that you want in the centerfold? You don't get that?
No.
Is that Mr. Hefner gets a little stamp of approval?
Yeah, we don't know what they're going to use. I was really bummed because my stuff was all, after you shoot the centerfold, you shoot all the other small pictures.
Right.
And I shot mine out in Texas.
Oh, in Texas.
Yeah, good old Texas. They wanted it to look like New England, and it was March, so.
Yeah, Texas, New England. That's a close comparison. Yeah. Oil wells in the background, yeah. you know, phony lobsters. Now, the other pictures that you did, now, you had a carnival theme in your thing.
I hated that.
Yeah, see, I practiced these
that
things.
That was the one thing that, they actually paid like a lot of money. They set that up just for me.
And that was in Texas?
It was in Texas.
Right.
And I hated that picture because it made I'm little, and it made my hips look like, you know, huge. And everyone was like, and
especially
being
hanging around all those
carny
folks, those whack jobs out there. So,
that
I mean, now the finished product was you on a merry-go-round.
Yes, it was. That was.
You don't even remember your own centerfold?
Wait a minute. Oh, the centerfold, yes. No, the centerfold
I just got touched by the playmate. Yeah. Right.
No, the centerfold was actually in a studio. It looks like. Yeah, that was. It's a studio shot.
The other thing.
And you know what? Little thing. I heard that Donald Trump bought that horse that I was on.
Really?
For his daughter. I'd like to get it back.
Now, after the Playboy thing, you went on to the Playboy Extreme team.
I did.
Now, we're talking about, you were in Borneo over in, where is that, Asia?
Malaysia.
Sorry, I didn't get that correct. And what did you, now you were on this Extreme team, like, give us the 411 on what happened over there in the Eco Challenge.
Well, I've always been athletic, and you know, after 5-6 years of signing autographs, it kind of gets boring, and I'm like, I want to do something that's more fulfilling. Mm-hmm. And so Danelle Folta and I started the Playboy Extreme team, and we started with little races, like 20, like 5-6 hour races.
Just little ones. 5-6 hour races.
And then we're like, well, the next step, we'll do the a 24 hour race. Well, Mark Burnett, who everyone knows is the producer of every show that's on TV right now.
Mr. Survivor.
Yeah, Survivor and everything else. He had this race called Eco Challenge, and he called us up and asked if we would be their celebrity team. And we were like, sure, no problem. And it was grueling. I only had about, people train for 1 year for this. Like, these are real athletes that train for like 12 months is usually the minimum. And I had 4 weeks.
4 weeks.
4 weeks. So I went through sleep deprivation camp, and I...
Colonel's an expert at that down there.
And I basically just strapped a backpack on my back with 30-pound free weights in there and just walked from town to town to town. Because the biggest part is your feet.
Right.
You get the rot, you know, your feet. My feet, when I started that race, were a size 6. When I finished, they were like 8.5.
Really?
So they were...
Now,
huge.
You guys, you were the underdogs. No one expected you guys to finish anywhere.
We had people that came up to us when we got there. They were so mean to us. They were like, what are you doing here? You guys aren't athletes. And we all right, so what? We look cute. We all had matching outfits. We had matching bikes. But we also had all the press.
Really?
And they were ticked about that because they wanted the press.
You know, Lou Ferrigno's running around, or Playboy Playmates. Who do you think they're going to go on?
During the race, you see these people, and they saw us struggling and crying, and then we started gaining their respect because, wow, they made it. They made it to this PC. They made it to this PC. And then we finished. And those same people that were making fun of us and yelling at us, they were hugging us and saying how proud they were, and, oh, we knew you could do it.
And what place did you guys finish?
I don't even know what we finished. 78 teams started, only 44 finished.
Really?
So we were just one of the teams that finished.
Unbelievable.
We knew we weren't going to place. I mean, come on, it's crazy.
Come on. Now, and I heard through the grapevine that there's going to be a movie based on
this? Yes. I can't really say too much.
Well, who would you want to have play you in the movie?
I thought it was supposed to be Jessica Alba or Jennifer Garner.
Really?
But I heard there's 3 girls that were cast for the role.
Why don't you go for it yourself?
Well, I'm going to be in it. I'll do like a cameo.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
A cameo?
Yeah, they have big stars playing us.
Really?
Like Cameron Diaz and...
Yeah, she's not that big anymore.
Well,
she used to be.
Big.
What we're going to do right now is we're going to take a big-time commercial break, and I want to thank you so much for being on the program. Sabrina's been working to try to get you on this program for 15 years.
We've
only been doing
Sabrina.
The show for 5, but we've been trying to get you on here for 15 years. So I'm the host of the program. Come here, Jenny, right here. All right.
Thank you.
All right. We're going to go to a big-time commercial break, and maybe we'll be back. Who knows? Bye.
All righty. Welcome back from that interview there. It's still a fascinating interview every time I hear it. Playboy magazine isn't what Playboy magazine used to be. Obviously, they don't have nudity in it anymore as of this year, 2016. And Capelli, what's your thought about that?
Again, I think it's ridiculous because, don't get me wrong, and like I said, stated previously,
right.
I like the idea of my mind, you know, leaving it open for imagination.
Sure.
It's nice to see the sexiness.
Pure imagination, like in Willy Wonka.
Pure imagination. Yeah, that's right. So I like not seeing everything, but so close to it. It
right.
is sexy. It's hot.
It is.
It makes it's lusty. But there's also something about seeing a beautiful naked woman, you know, posing, whether it be...
It's God's creation.
Exactly. And I don't know. Can I tell you one thing, though?
Sure.
Her voice... I mean, 6 to midnight here. We just started listening to her voice.
Wasn't that a... No, that was 10 to midnight. That was a Charles Bronson movie.
Yeah, no, this was 6 to midnight.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, Colonel, that was a fascinating interview there. But getting back to your midget ventriloquist, how many other weird people have you met on the beach that you try to get on the show?
I mean, I meet so many, you know?
You do meet so many. You are a walking conspiracy. And speaking of that, when we come back after this big-time commercial break, we're going to introduce a new segment on the program, Conspiracy Connection. Alrighty, welcome back from that big time commercial break. That was, of course, backtothefuture.com. They're still selling those fascinating miniature magnet hoverboards. Proceeds go to the Michael J. Fox Foundation. And we're going to talk about conspiracy connection. Now, for those of you out there who've been listening to the podcast, know that I am a huge fan of conspiracies, whether it be this, that, or whatever. I have, speaking of Back to the Future, Vinny Capelli, my esteemed one of my co-hosts over there, is holding the Michael J. Fox, Marty McFly Jr. hat from Back to the Future 2. This has nothing to do with conspiracy connection, but I needed a hat to put in the conspiracy. So what we're doing here, ladies and gentlemen, is we have a hat. Now, Capelli, you can testify that it is a hat.
It's in my hand. It is. I got to tell you, man, this thing's just groovy to look at.
It is,
man.
Funky, huh?
With the mood lighting, too? Unbelievable.
Right.
Really, right now.
Jeff, you're always out there. What does that look like to you, the Marty McFly hat?
Well, those are kind of, it's kind of tie-dye and kind of groovy to look at and everything. And I've seen a couple of the young hippie chicks. Those are the in thing for the hippie chicks to wear. But what's with the hat? What are we doing?
Okay, I'm going to explain what the hat is. Like I said, conspiracies are a big topic in my life. I love conspiracies, always have loved them. What really is the truth? What isn't the truth? Who knows? What we're going to do on the next podcast is we're going to have a whole segment dedicated to one conspiracy. Now, in that hat, I have three pieces of paper that I wrote down, three of the biggest conspiracies of all time. No one on the panel but me knows what's on that paper. Now, Vinny Capelli, I know that you're into conspiracies as well, so I'm not going to let you pull it out. I'm going to let Jeff, who is a skeptic on things, pull out the conspiracy that we're going to talk about. Now, there are three pieces of orange paper. Now,
He pulled out one. There's still two more in there.
There's two more in there. All right, Jeff, I need you to open up the paper and read what the conspiracy that we're going to talk about on the next episode is.
Okay, well, it's this post-it paper, so it's all stuck together. Bull, did you have this paper in the bathroom with you?
No.
Wow.
Okay.
You having a hard time? You want me to do it for you?
Maybe you had to move it and roll up your doctor's medicine.
All right.
Touché, Colonel. Touché.
I got to get this thing open before I get into some real trouble here. Oh, 9/11.
Oh,
really?
9/11. We're going to be talking about the conspiracy about 9/11. Was it an inside job? What really took place 15 years ago this month? We're going to talk about that for a whole segment on the next show. Do you believe that 9/11 was an inside job? Do you know about Building 7?
Well, I have a question.
Sure.
I have a question. Is it a conspiracy that he pulled the 9/11?
That's why
so close to 9/11?
Well, maybe it was the podcast gods looking down on us because I put in three conspiracies in there. I'm not going to mention the other two because we'll pull that out for the future conspiracy connections. Jeff, that's why I had him do it, because if you did it, people would think we were in on it and whatnot. Jeff, I haven't seen since the last podcast. He knew nothing about this. You knew nothing about this. Colonel knew nothing about this. And he pulled out 9/11. Could that be a conspiracy that he pulled out 9/11?
Something's strange here. I feel like a screen's coming at me saying stranger things right now.
Feel like what? Now, 9/11. Of course, that was a tragic day in American history. We're not going to go into any of the conspiracy tonight, but I am going to go around the panel and ask, where were you when you find out about 9/11, Colonel Bull Montana?
Well, I was in my house and I was watching the news. And my buddy Ralph, he's a bus driver over in...
Ralph Cramden?
No.
Ralph buddy, Squillante?
No, my buddy Ralph, he drives for the Paul Revere bus line. And where I live, I lost two good friends of mine. What happened to be two of the stewardesses. That live in my town.
Really? That's how you found out? You turned on the news and whatnot?
Yep.
Okay. Jeff, where did you find out about 9/11?
Well, I was working for the city of Boston at the time, and I was in the trucks, and around the time the planes hit, I was at Dunkin' Donuts at the time, and I was looking up and for some I. And that was right after the first plane hit. I was in the Dunkin' Donuts buying the coffee and everything. And then we started hearing about it on the news, and I said, do me a favor, turn on Howard Stern for me and because he's right down the street from 9/11 and everything. He's broadcasting from New York, and he did an amazing job broadcasting that day. It was very frantic, and it was very emotional and everything. So I was at work at the city of Boston and everything, and they sent us home early, half day. So, I can't feel lucky and everything, but I do remember where I was.
I do remember that Howard Stern broadcast. I don't remember if the actual day happening, but it's now available on YouTube, and you can listen to it in its entirety. It is a piece of history.
Yes.
They were actually talking about, coincidence, Pamela Anderson on that particular episode, where Howard was supposed to get a lap dance from her at one of the Scores nightclub. And here we are 15 years later, and she's talking about anti-sex. But Vinny Capelli, where were you on the morning of Tuesday, September 11th, 2001?
Well, I got to tell you. So I was working at the time, and I had gone back to the shop I was working at. And someone had said, hey, a plane struck one of the World Trade Centers. I said, I heard there was something on the radio about an accident at one of the World Trade Centers. So I happened to be sitting in the office, and we were waiting for something else to come in. So I'm watching the television, the news feed at the time, and I actually watched live the second plane strike the second tower.
Right, because the first plane wasn't on TV.
Right. And then I was just like, oh, my God. And then you knew. It was a terrorist attack. It wasn't an accident. It was a terrorist attack. And then all of a sudden, then they talked about a fire being done at the Pentagon, and then it was discovered that it was a plane that crashed in the Pentagon as well.
Or was it? We'll find out in the next episode.
But that's where I was. And then, yeah, that kind of really ended the day. After that, I had my little brother who was in school, and a lot of reports were going around of different terrorist things. And really, they succeeded in what they wanted and put this place into terror. And I remember having to go home, and the most eeriest thing was the next 2 days when there was no planes in the sky. It was just quiet.
It was.
And
I remember
that.
It
was eerie.
How I found out about it was, I'm a night owl. Everybody knows that down here. This was back in the early days of the internet. I still had dial-up. So I was asleep, and my cell phone rang. I mean, I had one of those old Nokia cell phones, and I'm like, who's calling me this early? Everybody knows this is after hours, and I love after hours. And it was about 9:30 in the morning on a Tuesday, and the phone kept ringing and ringing and ringing and ringing. This is long before Vibrate. So I picked up the phone, and it was Jeff and I's longtime friend Brett calling me from, he lived up in New Hampshire, and he goes, you got to go downstairs and turn on the TV. They're flying planes in the building and shit all over the country, blah, 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 blah. And I go, what? Is this a joke? You're waking me up. And sure enough, I went downstairs and turned on the television, and there it was right in front of me. I turned it on. The second plane had already hit, and they were showing the replay over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. And then I saw one building collapse. Then I saw the second building collapse. Now, I have been into conspiracies since I saw JFK in 1991, the Oliver Stone masterpiece, which made me think outside the box. I watched that day and said, this is very suspicious. And that day I kept going around, telling people, what happened is a tragedy. Human beings died for no reason whatsoever. It was a senseless tragedy. But what is the real story behind this? And then I started doing investigating, on the internet and whatnot, and listening to people who kept talking about, different, conspiracies and whatnot. Do I know what happened that day? No. But there is a lot of evidence out there that points the finger that it may not be what they're telling us.
We've got to save that for the
next show. And that's what we're going to talk about on the next show. So your homework assignment until our next podcast is to go online and research. Do the research yourself. Don't believe anything that I say. Do the research yourself, because that's what I did. And yes, Jeff, you have something to say?
No, I was going to say, talking about conspiracy theorists, Jesse the Body Ventura.
a show on it.
Yeah. It was called Conspiracy Theory.
Yes, we should get him on the show.
Well, you know, since you're good friends with the former governor out there, Jeff, maybe you could get along perfect with him now. He's trying to legalize marijuana.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Like we would get along so great and everything. At like my childhood. Well, he's not really my childhood icon and everything, but yeah, it would be great to do a little something with Jeff Z the Body.
And you've done a little something with our good friend the Iron Sheik.
Yeah, well, I want to stay away from cursing him because, I know he's, we all know he's just peddling around wheelchair bound, but I'm going to be seriously bummed when that man passes away.
Oh,
so I just don't want to talk about it.
He is an icon. Well, you're wearing a hat, so he's safe.
Right.
So what we're going to do is we're going to wrap up this episode of the After Hours of TC Restani podcast. I hope you enjoyed the episode, and please stay tuned for more episodes because this is After Hours, and we what?